Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the house of the Lord today. God's good to us, giving us a beautiful day in which to worship, and we appreciate that. So we welcome every one of you, members and visitors alike. And you out in the radio listen audience, we appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the next hour we can be an inspiration to you. And you would do us a favor and do many people a favor if you'd call them on the phone out there in the radio listening audience and have them to tune in and get the Northside Baptist Church Hour. We'd appreciate that very much. If you have your Bible, you turn to the book of Acts chapter 16. I'm going to speak to you today on this subject, the Jailhouse Rock. Acts chapter 16, I begin reading on page 1171. 1171 in Acts chapter 16. In a moment, I begin reading with verse 16, speaking on the Jailhouse Rock. This message and the music will be on cassette tape. We tape all of our Sunday morning programs. They're available for you in the radio listening audience or here in the auditorium. We send them out for a gift of $3 each, and the money is used to help pay for radio time. And if you'd like to have this tape or any of the tapes we're sending out, we'd be glad to accommodate you in this manner. The tape today will be tape number 120. 120 is the number of this tape, the Jailhouse Rock. If you'd like to have it, write for it. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Now in Acts chapter 16, I began reading with verse 16. And it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us. I remember that Luke is the one that wrote the book of Acts. And he said, Paul and us, that means he was with the party, and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrates, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison and charged a jailer to keep them safely. Who had received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house. Now that's reading from Acts chapter 16, verses 16 through 34. I want to speak to you today pertaining to this narrative, finding out what took place here and why it took place. Now God sent a great miracle, we know that, and he shook down the foundations of the jail, and the old jail began to rock. The walls began to crumble. The doors began to open. The bands began to break loose from the prisoners. And this is one of the greatest jailhouse rocks that you ever read about or know about. This is a direct intervention by Almighty God to deliver his servants and to save this jailer and his family. Now I want us to notice several things here. Number one, we see a picture of a demonic possession. Here we find in verse 16, and it came to pass as he went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. Now here we find a woman that you might call a witch in Bible days, or you would call maybe a fortune teller today, or someone that dealt with spiritism, or some kind of means of contacting Satan powers, satanic powers, and the underworld to be able to help predict the future. Now she had to get her power from Satan, as she was demon possessed. And you better beware of mediumism and spiritualism and things of that type, where you go into these secret places or so-called places of fortune tellers, or go to someone to try to get information other than from the Word of God and from the God of heaven. It could be a very dangerous thing. Now, this woman was demon possessed. We have a lot of demon possession in the land today. And the young people today in this rock and acid rock and punk rock music today, hard rock music, they are opening the way for young people to become demon possessed. Now, you'd be surprised at the demon activity that you find among this hard rock or acid rock or punk rock music that you find today that's beat out, like the music that you find in Africa among the heathen, and I don't know whether you call it music or not, but we'll just use that term. And they get together and they use some titles that are in the gutter, and they stoop as low as they can, and they beat out this jungle beat, and they turn the young people on, and they open up and many times become demon possessed and get on dope and strong drink. And that's why you have so many young people a day that's killed in car wrecks. And so many of our young people, they're committing suicide. They have been turned on by this ungodly, hellish rock music, which is very, very dangerous, and I hesitate to call it music. The lyrics are terrible because they're so suggestive. They encourage participating in dope and anything else that can turn you on. And they are turned on. Young people are turned on by demon powers. As I said before, this nation has never been the same among our youth since those beetle bugs came over here from England, and a bunch of rock and roll leaders that were reared up in this country took over. So you parents need to try to shield the young people. Now, I said this before, and some of you might not like it. The most dangerous stage that your daughter could get in, or your son, is for them to have their own private room, the own private phone, the own private radio, the own private record player or tapes, and go into that room and lock the door and sit there hours at a time and listen to that hard rock music. That's one of the most dangerous positions that your child can get in. Now, if that's the situation in your home, you better check into it. Now, a lot of you young people might not like this, but it's the truth whether you like it or not. And many of those young people that do that eventually end up on alcohol or cigarettes or grass or dope of some kind. And they follow that kind of stuff. And finally, their health is gone. They're demon possessed. And many of them commit suicide and end up in a devil's grave. Now, that's pathetic, but it's true. And this poor woman here, no doubt she was a maybe attractive woman, but she's demon possessed. And she made her living, and she brought wealth to the people that control her through telling the fortunes of the future, trying to flatter God's men. In verses 17 and 18, the Bible said she followed Paul and Silas, or the group he had with him, his party. said, "These men are the servants of the Most High God." Now, she was telling the truth. They were God's servants. But she was trying to flatter them, because that was a method and means she was using in order to gain her objective. And she did this for many days and grieved Paul. And Paul detected she was demon-possessed, and he cast that demon out of her. And when he cast the demon out of her, she could no longer tell fortunes. She had not the power of Satan to do so when she lost the demon, when the demon was cast out of her. So Paul cast out that demon. Now, she was owned by some men. They used her to go out and make money for them. And of course, as soon as they saw what had happened to her, naturally they became very angry. And that leads to our second thought, and that is a picture here of selfishness and cruelty. Now, these men that possessed this woman had no feeling for her whatsoever. And you'd be surprised today to know the men, even old men or middle-aged men, that have possessed young people to go out and live in sin and be prostitutes for them, that they might make gain by what they do. Now, that's all over the land. That's happening all over the land. Today, there's thousands of young girls that's running away from home in their teens, and they usually end up in the underworld or controlled by a gang of men that use them in order to make money from their prostitution. Now, that's happening all over the land. Now, that's what was happening here. These men use this poor woman. They had no feeling for her. And men today do likewise. Whenever a young girl gets to the place where she can't be used to sell dope or used as a prostitute, they cast her aside or they put her away. They'll kill her. They'll destroy her. And her parents will never know what happened to their daughter. She's been used until she's used up by these ungodly men, and then they kill her like a dog that's no good. And so here these men didn't like it because they lost their income when this woman lost that demon. Now, they used her. They had no feeling for her. They didn't care about her health. They didn't care about her future. They had no feeling for her. They used her. They were concerned only for the money they made through her. They wanted that money coming in, and they cared nothing about the poor woman. Now, the Bible said the love of money is the root of all evil. Not money itself, but the love of money. And you have evil taking place here, and it was the love of money that produced this. Now, they had seen the men of God whipped and mistreated. They didn't care about that. The men that owned this woman didn't care how badly they whipped these preachers, because they instigated themselves. They encouraged it. In verses 23 and 24, "And when they laid many stripes on them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who had received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks." Now, they didn't only take these preachers like they were two gangsters and put them in the inner prison, that is, on the inside where they couldn't get out. In addition to that, they put their feet fast in iron stocks. They fastened them down in that room so they'd be sure they could not get out. They had no mercy on these preachers, no mercy on the men of God. Now we find here in the third place a picture of a heaven-born happiness. Now, if that had been the average Baptist sitting in that prison, it cold and their backs beaten and bloody and their feet in chains and their hands in chains, they'd have been grumbling. They'd have been saying, "Well, why do I deserve this? This is not my day." But no, they didn't do that. In verse 25, the Bible says, "At midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them." Now, they were singing here at the midnight hour. They had been whipped and beaten and thrown in prison, and now it was midnight, and they were singing and praising God. In the book of Job, chapter 35 and verse 10, the Bible said, "But none saith, where is God my maker, or who giveth the song in the night?" God can give you a song in the night. I don't care how dark it may become in your home or wherever you may be, God can still give you a song in the night. Now, these prisoners in this prison couldn't very well get away from what they heard. They could have maybe stopped up their ears, but they couldn't run off. They couldn't say, well, we're not going to listen to these preachers sing and pray and preach. We'll just leave. They couldn't do that. They were in jail. Paul and Silas had a congregation that had to listen or either stop up their ears. And so at midnight, they took the advantage of that situation, and they began to sing. I don't know what they sang. I'll ask Paul when I get to heaven or ask Silas, because I'd really like to know. I'm a little bit concerned about what they sang, so I'll find out later about what they sang. But I don't know if they'd had the old song, Amazing Grace, in that day. I just believe they'd sang Amazing Grace. But they evidently did sing about the grace of God. And they sang, no doubt, they sang some of the Psalms. They used that in those days. They used the Psalms and sang them. And no doubt they were singing some of the Psalms, or maybe some hymn, a spiritual song. But they were singing. They were rejoicing. They were praising God. There they were, had blood cold on their backs and shoulders, their backs beaten and torn, and they're suffering. And yet they were praising God, and they were singing. And the Bible said the prisoners heard them. Romans 8:28 is still in the Word of God. All things work together for the good of those that love the Lord, that are thee called according to His purpose. So when you end up in some kind of predicament you can't understand, remember, if you're a child of God, born again, believing you love the Lord, remember Romans 8 and verse 28. If you don't have that verse of Scripture in your heart and mind, and you don't have it marked in your Bible, you ought to do so right now. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. We come to thought number 4. And we see here a picture of divine intervention. In verse 26, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, so the foundation of the prison was shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loose. My, we see the mighty power of God. We see a gigantic jailhouse rock. God began to rock this prison. The walls began to tremble. The walls began to fall. Their bands burst off their feet and off their hands. My, we see the power of God here at this jailhouse rock. No doubt they had prayed for those who despitefully used them. They had been whipped, and no doubt during the midnight hour, Paul said, Lord, I want to pray for those men that beat my back and caused my back to suffer and the blood to be coming from my body and that whipped Silas. Lord, we want to pray for them. No doubt they prayed for them. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 44, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. That's hard to do, but Jesus said, do it. And then in Psalms chapter 10 and verse 15, break thou the arm of the wicked and the evil man, seek out his weakness till thou find none. See, God is able to take care of the situation. God said, vengeance is mine and I will repay, and he knows how to do that. So here you have a picture of divine intervention. God looked down from heaven. They're in that cold jail there at Philippi. There at the midnight hour, two suffering preachers sitting there with their bodies covered with cold blood, sitting there with their clothing stuck to their bodies, no doubt, suffering yet praising God, suffering yet rejoicing, suffering and yet singing and testifying about the things of God. And so the Lord looked down from heaven. He saw all that taking place. I think old Dr. Bob Jones Sr. said, Gable said, Lord, let me go down and look over the situation. Went down and hung his big foot on the side of that jail, and down came the walls. I believe he's the one that used that illustration. But the walls came down, nevertheless, regardless of how it happened, it happened. Then we come to thought number 5, and that's a picture of deep conviction. Deep conviction. Now, in order to have a real, genuine convert, in order to get somebody really born again, there must be a deep conviction. Before a baby is born into the family, as a general rule, there comes birth pains. And when those birth pains begin, then you know a baby is soon to be born. You mothers as birth children, you know what I'm talking about. When those birth pains began, it won't be long until a son or a daughter be born into your family. And so conviction is a type of the birth pains. Conviction means that you are convicted of your past sins. You know you're a sinner. You're disturbed. And you want to do something about it. I've known people get under conviction and go for days, could hardly eat, and could hardly sleep. I believe I told the people here maybe Wednesday night. Many years ago, I had a tent up down here near Washington, Georgia. I preached one night. I don't remember just what I preached on. But I preached one night, and a young lady sitting in that auditorium, she left and went home that night, and she couldn't sleep. She cried. She was disturbed. She couldn't rest. All the next day, she couldn't rest. She came back to tent meeting that night, eyes red and swollen. She came to me and said, "Preacher, something's got to be done." Said, I haven't slept since I left here last night. I realized when you preached that I was lost and on the road to hell, and I want something done about it. My wife was standing there. I said, "Honey, take her there in the prayer room and lead her to Jesus." And my wife took that woman in the prayer room there at the tent and led her to Jesus. And of course, I checked on the situation because I want to be sure too that she had been saved, and she gave a wonderful testimony to the saving grace of God. But she was under conviction now for almost 24 hours, and she couldn't rest. And so whenever she got a chance to get saved, she wanted to get saved, get back to that tent and get saved, and she did. Now, when somebody like that gets saved, you have a genuine convert. Now, when you have somebody moving forward in invitation, they come down unconcerned and grinning and laughing and popping their chewing gum and don't much care whether they come to the altar or not, and they get out and they make out like they don't know or understand what you're talking about. You might as well send them back to the pew. They're not under conviction. They don't want to get saved. They've just been overpersuaded. They've been pulled green. Now you have a lot of church members been pulled green, and they soon sour up and you don't see them anymore. They get the name on the church roll. Many times they're baptized, but they're pulled green. They're not really saved. And then they come to church for a while, and then they're out. You don't see them anymore. They just stop short of salvation. Got to be careful in dealing with people lest you pull somebody green or get somebody to make a profession when it's not genuine. It's better to make no profession at all than to make a profession that's not genuine. That's why we have to be careful in dealing with people about their souls. Now they had deep conviction, verse 29, and he called for light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. Here's the old jailer, a hardened man, a strong man, no doubt. And he's under great conviction. He's trembling. He's disturbed. He can hardly walk. He's so upset. And he wants to be saved. He's under deep, pungent conviction. And he calls for light, but he got two kinds of light. He got the light that you could light up and see your way physically, and then later he got the light from heaven. And he took a rightful position before Paul and Silas. He fell down before them. He got out humble before them. And Jesus said, unless you enter in as a little child, you won't get in. And he humbled himself down before these preachers. And he said, what must I do to be saved? In Acts chapter 2 and verse 37, you have a similar case. Simon Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost, and he preached a gigantic message, and he told those people, you have crucified Jesus Christ, you have killed the Prince of Life. And they were so pricked in their hearts and convicted. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 37, when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Oh, they were concerned, they were disturbed, they were convicted, they were proven, it was proven to them that they had they're crucified their true Messiah. They said, we got to do something. What can we do, preachers? We got to do something. Simon Peter told them what to do. There's a man one time, a king, that thought he'd visit one of his prisons. This king went down and began to visit those inmates, and he came along and he asked this man his name, and the man said, my name is so-and-so, sir, but said, they didn't treat me right. I'm really not guilty of what they accused me of, sir. I'm an innocent man. And the king said, moved on to the next man. He said, what's your name? He told him. He said, you know, they framed me. I shouldn't be here, but they framed me and they put me here, and I shouldn't be here. I'm innocent. Went on to the next man, on and on he went. About a dozen fellows he interviewed, and every last one of them, they just weren't supposed to be there. They were innocent. They had been good men and never done anything wrong, and they couldn't understand why they were in prison according to their testimony. He went to one other man. He said, son, what is your name? He told him. And he said, why are you here, son? He said, well, I'm here, sir, because I deserve to be here. He said, I was a wicked criminal on the outside of prison. I committed crime. And he said, they tried me. And of course, I was guilty. And sir, I deserve to be right here where I am. The old king called the warden forward. He said, come here, sir. He said, I want you to take this man here and set him free. Because you don't want this man, this criminal here, that's guilty of all these crimes, be associated with all these other innocent people that's in here that's never done anything wrong. Get this criminal out and send him back home. You don't need him here with these fine innocent fellows. It'd be a bad influence over them. And so the man that was guilty and admitted his crime was set free. That's the only way unto heaven you'll ever be saved. If you try to tell God that you're not a sinner, like a man 88 years old, he said to the Lord, he said, Lord, I'm 88 years old and I'm too mean to be saved, Lord, and I'm too mean to go to heaven, Lord, so I want you to let me live on long enough to get good enough to come to heaven. Well, you don't get into heaven that way. You got to take your place before God as a sinner, admit your sinner, admit your loss, admit you're going to hell, admit you deserve to go to hell, and say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, and save me for Jesus' sake, or you'll never be saved. Now we find in the next step a picture of sudden conversion. Verses 30 and 34. He said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. In verse 34, and they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house, and he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his straightway. So here we find that he received a promise. If he would get saved, then he could win his house to God. He got saved, they went into his home, and there led his entire family to God. I'm going to say something right here, and I want you fathers, you dads, to listen to me. I'm firmly convinced that if a man will get saved and get right with God, if he has a wife and children in his home, he could have some influence over them in getting them to God. When I was saved, my wife wasn't present the afternoon I was saved. She was working. And I was in my home on the bed of affliction. My mother and the pastor there in Greenville, South Carolina, won me to God. When my wife came in from work, I told her that I'd been saved. At that time, Joan was just a small baby. And that night, we went to bed and we got to talking about it. I said to her, I said, I believe I heard the preacher say, if the Lord comes, all saved people go to heaven and little children will go to heaven and unsaved people won't go. I said, what if the Lord should come tonight? Then I would go and Joan would go and you'd be left here. That really shook her up. And as quick as she could get to a preacher, she was saved. Now, I said that to say this. I don't know what had happened to my family. Had I not gotten saved when I did, where in the world would I be today? Where would my wife be? Where would my family be? We might all be in hell. Now, there's some of you dads listening to me right now. You're keeping your family away from God and away from the house of God. You're leading your family to hell, and you know you are. And one of these days when you fall off into hell and your family come tumbling in behind you, it'll be too late then. If you're a man, I mean a man, I'm not talking about some jellyfish, I'm talking about a man. If you'd get right with God, you can have influence over your family. You might not win them all at one time. It might take you some time to get them to God, but you can do it if you're the right kind of man, especially if they're still under your roof. Now, if they're married and already going out in the world, I can't promise you'll get them to God. You might get some of them. But if they're in your home, you can get them to God. That's what they're talking about here. The preacher said, now listen, fella, if you'll get saved, you can get saved and your family can get saved. And this man got saved and they went into his house and they gave them the word of God in verse 34 and his whole family got saved. He was ready. He's given the word of God. He believed. And then they had a baptizing. Baptism follows salvation. Now, the Bible doesn't tell you you have to be baptized in water to be saved. Now, that's error. If you teach that or believe that, you believe wrong or you teach error. Baptism is for believers only. Amen. And believers are born again, saved people. And after you're born again, you should follow the Lord in baptism. That's a command. And so they did that. They followed the Lord in baptism that night. And the whole household got saved. Finally, I want you to notice number 7, a joyful fellowship. In verse 34, And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house. He rejoiced. Here's a happy man, a rejoicing man, because this man had gotten saved, his whole family had gotten saved, and they were happy. We see a man here saved from taking his life. He was ready to commit suicide. I've seen that happen. I had a man to walk into the church while I passed in Unionport. Some of you people sitting here today, you were there. And this man came and sat out in the service. And when we gave the invitation, he came forward and was saved. And he said, I want you to go out there and take that poison out of my luggage. And some of my deacons went out there and opened up his luggage. Right on the top there was some strychnine, some poison. And he said, I had that poison. I was on the way down here to these woods to commit suicide. I came by and I heard the singing. And I thought I'd stop in. And I stopped in. He stopped in. He sat down. He heard the singing. He heard the preaching. He came down and got saved. He's a long way from home. They took the poison out of his luggage. And then some of my deacons carried him home and fed him. And they carried him to the bus station and put him on a bus and sent him back home. He's from another state. That man was desperate and he was going to commit suicide that very morning. Now this jailer here was going to commit suicide, started to kill himself. Paul said, wait a minute. Now killing yourself is not the way out. You jump out of the frying pan in the fire. You don't kill yourself to get out of your trouble. That you get in trouble by killing yourself. And this man's going to kill himself. Paul said, don't do that. And this man was saved, and he went in and he washed the preacher's stripes. He washed their stripes. And he set food before them. He is willing to feed the preachers that night, although it was after midnight. And they had great fellowship and great joy, and they rejoiced together. What a happy home. I'd like to have been there and joined in on that. Wouldn't you like to see that scene? That was Paul and Silas and his party, and the old jailer got saved, and his wife got saved, and the children got saved, had a baptizing, and then they sat down, had a good meal, and they were shouting and praising God and rejoicing. They were having a wonderful time because of the jailhouse rock that night. There they were saved. If you're not saved today, you ought to turn to God now, because you never know when it could be too late. Let's stand to our feet. Our Father, I pray today you'll take the message and use it. Save somebody today, Father, out in the radio listening audience. Maybe somebody lost in this building needs to be saved. Lord, have your way in this invitation. May Jesus be honored. Use thy word. May thy name, our Father, be glorified today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, while Debbie plays a couple of stanzas on the organ, if you're in this building unsaved and you want to be saved, come down here. I'll help you to the Lord. If you're backslidden and want to come back into fellowship with God, you may come. If you're here and you're looking for a church home, don't have a good fundamental Bible-believing church home, you want to join Northside, come down and present yourself. I'll take over from there. And while she plays, for any reason you feel like you should come, come on while we wait. How about it today while we wait?